Okay, now speaking about these ideas and these theories, how about before getting into those, we talk about, well, you define what is space, what is time, what is dimension? These concepts will come up repeatedly, so let's have this precise common ground.
Well, as regards time, I always quote Ernst Mach, who says it's utterly impossible to measure the changes of things by time. Quite the contrary, time is an abstraction from that we deduce from change. So I think that there are instants of time, and I would now say that they are complete shapes of the universe, and that it's just time is just a succession of such shapes. That's more or less what Leibniz already said, Newton's great opponent with whom he debated many things. So that's how I think about time. And we just, I can perhaps illustrate it with this little model I've made here. I think you can see that.
Yeah.
Let each of those triangles represent an suppose the universe just consisted of three particles, then they would be at the vertices of a triangle at each instant. And so the reality are the three particles at the vertices of the triangle. And time is something that we put in between those instants to make it seem that they're evolving in accordance with Newton's law. But the reality is just that you go from one triangle to another. That's how I think about time. And there is a representation of Einstein's general relativity where simultaneity is restored. In fact, this is how I got into all this, by chance reading about an article that the great Paul Dirac, the great quantum theoretician, in 1958, he published a paper in which he said that if we're going to create a quantum theory of gravity, we're going to have to restore simultaneity, because if you imagine space-time like a loaf of bread, Einstein insisted that you could slice it in any way you like. And Dirac said, but that's an anathema for quantum mechanics, because you're just introducing redundant subsidiary degrees of freedom which have nothing to do with what's really happening. And this made a huge impression on me. And I think Dirac was quite right. Perhaps not precisely the way he put it in the mathematics that he did, but in essence, I think Dirac was right. And with collaborators, I think over the years we've shown that is a much better way to think about general relativity. And it also does match what we observe in the universe, because the microwave background defines a notion of rest to very great accuracy, really. And in many ways, that more or less coincides with the way Dirac thought about the universe. So that's basically how I think about time. Time is just the way we interpret the way that the shape of the universe changes.
You said that Dirac had a notion of simultaneity. How does that make sense with special relativity?
He was talking about general relativity, which replaced special relativity. So special relativity was made, really, I would say, redundant when Einstein created general relativity. It will still hold in local regions, the famous business of when you're falling freely in a gravitational field, that's when you can introduce something that is very, well, really it is special relativity then, but it's restricted just to your immediate neighborhood when you're in free fall. It doesn't really apply to the whole universe, and that's what Dirac was thinking about.
Now, we didn't get to definitions of space, but before we move on to the definition of space and also dimension, if we go back to that cardboard diorama that you had, if you don't mind holding it up.
Yeah, sure.
So one way of thinking of what time is time has duration and time has succession. And on here, you have these different slices. Now, are you saying that there is no difference between the different slices?
No, the slices are all different. I mean, they're my triangles. Each triangle is different from the other one. In fact, I would say what really counts is just the shape of the triangles if we're talking about the whole universe. But the shapes are all different in my model. What I'm saying is that I would say they define an instant of time. Each of them defines an instant of time, but duration is not really out there in the universe. It's something that we put in. The instants are there, but we put the duration between them.
Do we also put the ordering between them?
No, because that's in their intrinsic structure. If they evolve continuously and a certain quantity, in fact, this is exactly what does happen, certainly in Newton's theory of gravity, and I strongly suspect in general relativity too, there is a quantity which grows steadily. In Newton's theory, it doesn't grow absolutely uniformly, but it's always increasing with certain fluctuations like that. And this quantity is what we call the complexity, and that defines an arrow of time, which is nothing whatever to do with the increase of entropy. In fact, it's quite the opposite. It's an increase of order. So there can be, yes, there are differences. I would say each individual instant is distinct, just as two triangles of different shapes are distinct. I always illustrate everything with triangles because that's the simplest example you can take.
Okay, so let's abandon for now the notions of space and dimension in terms of definitions, because that may take us off course. Why don't you talk about Mach's principle, as that's central to your work?
So Mach, like Leibniz before him, said Newton's notions of absolute space and time just make no sense. Newton said that there is space exists like an infinite translucent block of ice in which you can describe straight lines. Now, you can do that if you've got a block of ice. You can take something and score a line along it. But if you tried to do that in an invisible space, you wouldn't leave any mark. So Leibniz said this is just nonsense. And Leibniz said space is the order of coexisting things. And when he was pressed what he meant by order, he said, I mean the distances between things. And then he said, time is just the succession of coexisting things. Whenever it was in 150, 160 years later, Mach essentially came back and said the same sort of things. And Mach's criticism of Newton's ideas was a big stimulus to Einstein, led him to create general relativity, but was very much part of that story. Mach's first criticism of Newton's ideas in 1870 in a little booklet led a young German called Ludwig Lange to propose the notion of an inertial system, which is what today we call an inertial frame of reference. So, and Lange showed in the simplest possible case with just purely inertial motion how, given the motions, you could determine what that inertial frame of reference is. And Mach said, yes, that's fine, but I think you really need to take into account the whole universe. So Mach's idea was that the local inertial frame of reference is determined by the relative positions and the relative motions of all the bodies in the universe. And that's how I define Mach's principle. Now, Einstein didn't follow Mach too closely. And in fact, in many ways, I think Einstein introduced a whole lot of confusions. Nevertheless, with a lot of help from wonderful mathematics and also other physics, he did create this wonderful theory of general relativity, which we would never have if Einstein hadn't been so determined to create the theory. But I think in the process, he created a tremendous muddle about what Mach's ideas really were.
Hmm.
So a lot of my life has been spent trying to sort out that muddle. But as a solitary person sitting in the countryside north of Oxford, people don't necessarily take you very seriously. They think Einstein's got to be right.
Don't forget to follow Theories of Everything with Curt Jaimungal on Spotify for exclusive content and in-depth discussions. Your support on Spotify helps us grow and to reach more curious minds like yours. Check out the link in the description and join the Core Toe community on Spotify today. See you there.